How do you hide a camel in the desert?
You flapalize him.
You camouflage him. Yeah, new material. Anyway, I want to start out, I want to share a little bit about my friend, and I've talked about him before, my atheist friend. Don't get scared, I got a friend, he's an atheist. Now, you know, he's been through his trials and tribulations. Me and him professionally were at the same level. We were both bankers. We're both at the same kind of income level, walking through that thing. And his marriage took a turn for the worse, and everything just kind of is still going downhill in his life. And the thing is, he don't know how to put the brakes on because he don't know how to relate to his Lord. See, he does have a Lord, even though he hasn't admitted to it. He still has a Lord who's on his side. So anyway, I went and saw him. He needed some help. I did some. He actually went through and he lost his home. And now here's a man my age. You know, I had it all together just a little while ago. Now I'm in the gutter. So he needed some help moving, and he's not the kind of guy that really asks for help. And you know what? I didn't see any of his atheist buddies volunteering to help him either. I didn't see none of his buddies who hung around and thought everything's peachy keen today showing up at his door to help him. But I helped him. I went over there and I saw how down he was. I was trying to get a trailer for him to help him move, but couldn't get it. So I got in my car and I went to the U-Haul place and I rented a U-Haul and I came back and I showed up and I got him out the house and we packed him up and moved him. Now, we went through that. He's over, he used to live by me and by all his friends who would stop by and, woo, whip it up. But now he's way over in Dunes West and zero friends anymore. Where's all his friends? So yesterday he needed some help with something and he wanted to pay me for helping him move. And he said, well, if you can come help me, I want to pay you too. And so I went over there and visited with him for a minute and fixed the issue he had. And he says, listen, there's a personal item he had, a personal possession, and he knew I liked. And he said, listen, I'd like to give you this in exchange if you would accept it versus paying you. Now, the situation here is the item was four times the value of what he owed me. See, we're getting somewhere, see? I don't beat him in the head with the Bible because he's not ready for it. I don't share a lot of scripture with him because he's not ready for it. But what I do is I do things for him. I share time with him. So in that, his roommate was talking to him because he had shared this with his roommate. And his roommate, not saying it out of you shouldn't give it to him, but said, now, are you sure? You know, that's a valuable item. And my friend Wally stopped and said, you know what? In the midst of my storm, he's the only guy who would show up. He's the only guy who helped me. He's the only guy who's... He deserves something from me that he ain't even asking for. Now, I'm not saying that to boast on me, but see, I've got to show him Christ through me, see? I'm the vessel that has to show him Christ in me. See, I can't... He knows Scripture. He was raised up in a Christian home. He might know the Scripture more than I do. But see, he's not going to listen to me telling him about the Scripture right now. But he's seeing some of the fruits. And he's enjoying in the fruit and our fellowship together. Now, trust me, there's going to be a time down the road where I'm going to walk in and say, Wally, we need to talk about a few things. When that time is right, trust me, I'm the man for the job. And we're going to talk. And I've earned his trust and respect that he's going to listen. But I want to encourage you with that today. Because see, we always want to fix people just like that. Well, you know the Word says. Well, you know the Word says. Sometimes it's best just to show them what the Word says instead of telling them. You have to show them the Word. You know what I'm saying? It's good to know the Word, but it's more impressive upon them to see the Word. And they see the Word in what you do. So just use that as encouragement. If you have a friend like mine or someone who's just out there, just love them. Just show them a helping hand, a hug. You know, we didn't do, I went over there, I fixed the problem, we sat and talked, we watched a little football, and I left. But I'm there for him. I'm there for him. The light's going to come on. That switch is going to be flipped one day. And then prayers that his mom and his stepdad have been praying for him, and the prayers that I've been praying, and this church has prayed for him, they're going to come to full realization. And you're talking about a guy that's going to be on fire for God. Get out of the way. Get out of the way. See, I'm looking on to the things that aren't as though they are. So I'm already down the road. I'm just waiting for him to catch up a little bit. So just continue to lift him up in prayer. You know, I'd like to get about 50 of those guys. Well, I'd like about 150, but I can only work at one at a time. See, you can only get close one at a time, or you'll burn yourself out trying to save everybody. You can't save them. They got to come to the end of their own rope for that, and Jesus will work through them. Exactly. Show them your faith by your works. So that was just a little update to kind of tell you, trust me, it gets in them. You just got to wait for it to be revealed. Okay? All right. Well, I'm going to touch on something. Now, listen. We know what condemnation and conviction are. So I'm going to say some things. God's talked to me about this a while back and just waited for the opportune time to get up and minister on it. This isn't condemnation. This is to hope to get some conviction in some hearts, okay? And sometimes we have to stand in the gap. So I'm going to read some scriptures, and then we're going to talk a little bit about something. So I'm in the Amplified. You can put up Ephesians 5, 25. Now, before we go into it, let me say that I am not the perfect husband. Nowhere close. I know you're shocked. Come on. I fail in a lot of areas a lot of times. But now, I also know that I do a lot of things right. So those things that I'm missing, my wife lets me know. That's our personal relationship. She don't get on Facebook and tell everybody. She don't text them. If it's a big enough problem that we have to see our pastor about it, we will come see our pastor about it. So there's things in my life that, boy, Lord, why do I mess up in these areas? But I got the basics down. See, I prayed for this woman, and God brought her to me. I literally said one day in my office at my job, Lord, I'm done looking for that woman. I quit. I'm going to let you send her to me. And sure enough, I think it was within that week or this following week, I met Rachel. And that wasn't a coincidence, and that wasn't just a chance meeting. I knew it right from the moment that we really listen, we went on one afternoon date, and I knew this is her, this is the answer to the prayer. And that's why, see, conviction gets on me sometimes because I say, God, you answered my prayer with this woman, a godly woman, and I fall short. Help me in those areas. Help me. So this isn't just for y'all. It's for me too. So we'll talk about this here. 5:25. Husbands, love your wives as Christ loved the church and gave himself up for her. Well, that's powerful. You could stop there, Pastor Bob. We could go for a month and a half right there. Love your wives as Christ loved the church. Husbands, that's a tall order. Let's go to 26. Why? So that he might sanctify her, having cleansed her by the washing of the water with the word. Wow. So there's a reason. And it's not about you. It's about him, Christ. Big commandment about loving your wife.
What's the result of loving your wife?
Mm.
He will sanctify her.
That's right.
Woo!
That's right. So think about it. Let's pause for a minute. You mean if I don't love my wife the way that Christ loved the church, I might hinder your sanctification of my wife? Woo! Well, let me tell you what sanctification is. Let's just put it in simple terms. Christ drawing you closer to him and maturing you in your Christian walk. Becoming more accountable to your Lord and Savior. Lord, I used to do some things I can't do anymore because, see, now that I'm closer to you, I'm more accountable to you. I could do them. But see, since I want to be close to you, I got to be more accountable to you. Thank you for sanctifying that area of my life. That's it. Yes, that's right. It's no regulation law. It's a relationship. Relationship. Does that answer that?
Yes, sir.
You're welcome. Down to 27. That he might present the church to himself in glorious splendor, without spot or wrinkle or any such things, that she might be holy and faultless. Again, men, don't be hindering. Do your best to love your wives as Christ loved the church. Number 28. Even so, husbands should love their wives as being in a sense their own bodies. He who loves his own wife loves himself. Boy, this is where the rubber meets the road. Men out there saying they love their wife. And then when you see their fruits, there ain't no love in that fruit. When you cheat on your wife, you're cheating God. And you're cheating yourself. Cheating God and you're cheating yourself. Well, I think I can get away with it. No, you cannot. Don't cheat God. I tell a lot of couples who they think they can't stand each other anymore and they can't, oh, well, did you get married? Yeah, we got married. Did you get married under Christian principles? Oh, yes, we did. Then what foolishness is coming out of your mouth? See, under Christian principles, you have a covenant. A God covenant. You know, I've said this before and I'll share it again. There's nothing my wife can do to make me hate her. Now, the world says, oh, she could cheat on you. She could lie still. There's nothing she can do to override my love for her. I have my own willpower. I have my own covenant. She can't change my covenant. I will love her through anything because that's my covenant. And see, I like God so much that I don't want to mess up that covenant with him. Think about it. If men would stop and think about that covenant, and women too, you wouldn't see the problem we have in marriages today. But see, it's about them. It's become about them and not God. Think about God before you make a mistake that you will pay a price for. For no man ever hated his own flesh, but nourishes and carefully protects and cherishes it at Christ, as Christ does the church. Number 30, because we are members, parts of his body. Number 31, now here we go. For this reason, a man shall leave his father and mother. A lot of men can't get over that step right there. A lot of parents can't get over that step right there. And you see another issue in marriage. And shall be joined to his wife, and the two shall become one flesh. If that one scripture could get in the hearts of people before they say, I love you, I do. If they would realize that, you mean I'm leaving my mom and dad and I'm going to become one with this woman, that we're one flesh? See, it's a serious, that's serious in my book. I mean, that's a supernatural thing. But so many parents don't want to leave their children alone. I remember what Rachel's dad told mom, Missy. Let me try that again. Missy. He's got a very deep voice. We're the Knoffels. They're the Fergusons. We live here. They live over there. We do what we do. They do what they do. Wisdom. Wisdom. You know, he knew, okay, she's a mom. It's natural. But I got to tell you, you can't do that now. You got to have moderation. My mom and dad did the same thing. We are not interfering in your relationship. If you need us, we're here. If you need advice. But we don't tell you how to live your marriage. If that could get in. Now, men, I'm marrying Rachel. She's my wife, but I got to think of her as me. Oh, I need to treat her a little differently than if I thought the other way. See, you want to treat yourself bad. Think about it that way. If I'm treating my wife that way, I'm really treating myself this way. Rubber meets the road, Pastor Bob. Think about it. Whatever I do to her, I'm doing to myself. Whatever I do to her, I'm doing to me. And then I'm also doing it to God. I'm doing it to God. God-centered marriages do not fail. But when you step out of that realm and go to the selfish mode, it will fail every time. Every time. You take every divorce in the history of divorces and you will go back to a root of selfishness. Think about it. This mystery is very great, but I speak concerning the relation of Christ and the church. 33. However, let each man of you, without exception, love his wife as being in a sense his very own self. And let the wife see that she respects and reverences her husband. Stop. My wife's going to have to love me and respect me. Show me I'm the boss. Yeah, that's what I said. See, that's what men want. But they forget the sentence above that. See what I'm saying? My wife's going to respect and reverence me because I'm me. I'm the man. Ain't going to last. She might fake it for a while. You're the best, honey. I love you. However, let each man of you, without exception, love his wife as being, in a sense, his very own self. And then, let the wife see that she respects and reverences her husband, that she notices him, regards him, honors him, prefers him, venerates and esteems him. And that she defers to him, praises him, and loves and admires him. I like that verse. I want that. I like that. But I ain't going to get that around the clock. if I don't love her, if I don't show her a godly love, if I just do my part. See, men get into the habit of, well, I do my part. I bring the check home. That's all I got to do around here. That's like taking advice from a mechanic on how to fix the plumbing. Are you a mechanic or a plumber? Oh, yeah, I work on motors. Okay. Can I talk to a plumber? You know, you got to get this thing down in your spirit, see? I love my wife as Christ loved the church, and then I get that benefit? Woo! Yeah! Pot roast, steak, potatoes. Go to 1 Peter 3:7. The benefits of doing it the right way. 1 Peter 3:7. In the same way, you married men should live considerately with your wives. I like this verbiage. With an intelligent recognition of the marriage relation. Honoring the woman as physically the weaker, but realizing that you are joint heirs of the grace, God's unmerited favor of life, in order that your prayers may not be hindered and cut off. Otherwise, you cannot pray effectively. Now, there's powerful scripture there again. Intelligent recognition. Duh. See, we get the duh syndrome a lot. Men do. Duh. But on the end of it, we want to think of ourselves as pretty smart. I know what I'm doing. I know what I'm saying. I know what I'm thinking. But do we stop and recognize the value of our wife? Amen. It's a blessing, men. It's a blessing. I remember before I was married, I was living in a house, my friends, and they were overseas. And I stayed in their house and took care of their place while they were gone. And they called one day. And see, this is how God will protect you in your life if you'll let him. Hey, Charles, listen, our friend, and I knew the girl, so-and-so called, and she's got to move, and she needs a place to stay temporarily and all. Do you mind if she comes to the house and stays? This is the flesh talking for a minute. This girl was good-looking, Pastor Bob. I mean, she's a good-looking girl. I think I might let her stay. That's the flesh now. But see, I knew, whoop, I said, Lewis, Leslie, listen, it's your home. If you want her to come stay, that's fine, but I'll move out. I know enough to know that I don't want to live with no woman until I'm married to that woman. Because see, I let God show me there's pitfalls involved with that, son. Oh, now, see, the world will say the different. Oh, that's innocent. I mean, you're just kind of roommates. If you can show me a man who starts off that way and still thinks that way at the end of that roommate relationship, you win. But you ain't going to show me that because I know men. I'm one. Okay? It might start out all innocent and good intention. But it's like I say, if you put yourself where you're not supposed to be, you'll end up doing stuff you ain't supposed to be doing. So he protected me then. And I knew it. I had enough wisdom to know, no, you get tangled up in that, you'll end up in a world of mess. And then one day when I prayed for Rachel, God might have said, I got to work on you still, boy, because see, you got some kind of a issue there that you might slip up and have some eye for some woman because, see, you haven't learned some things yet. So I know to go back and rewind. Boy, if I'd have stumbled right there, could have messed up my entire relationship with women. Would have gave me a whole different attitude. It would have changed the way I thought about them. I wouldn't have any reverence or anything like that. I wouldn't know the benefit other than one benefit. Without getting graphic, you know, that's what man says. Hey, I got my woman. No, I didn't know. I didn't want that. I wanted this one. So, yeah, watch out now. So, let me tell you what, you know, vexes my spirit. We have a lot of men today who are sleeping. They're missing in action. I know we have wives here that husbands don't come. I know there's many in churches all across the world. Satan's got a grip on this attitude in men. You know, I'm the man, I'm in charge. I do what I want. I bring home the check. If I want to sit on Sunday, y'all go to church, do what you want to do. But the man still wants to be the leader. But see, he's not leading. He's commanded to be the spiritual leader of his home, but yet he don't want to get off the sofa on Sunday. He's commanded to be the spiritual leader of his home, but he don't want no input on anything other than, leave me alone. I want to do what I want to do because I'm tired. I've been working. And don't challenge me. I'm the leader. But see, he ain't the leader. So my heart goes out. That's why I was saying, it's not about condemnation, it's about conviction. I want some men to hear this and get convicted. See, I'm a man, so I can't have ministry in one-on-one relation with women. I'm a man, so I'm looking for these men, and they're missing. Where are my men? I know they exist. I hear about them. I see them. Never here. Out there. And again, I'm not putting them down. But I want to say this. If you're the wife, don't force feed it. Don't force feed it. You will lose that fight. One trap and one mistake women won't, they want to fight their husband about issues. You cannot win that fight. Now, that doesn't mean you roll over and but you do like our pastor's wife. Get in that closet and tell God. You want him to get convicted? You do that. You know, I blew it the other week and I was letting it out, and Rachel started praying right beside me. And the more she prayed, the less my volume got. And the more she prayed, the less my volume got. And I finally just was driving, trying to look at the road without looking at the road. I was just going along at a steady pace. Now, I didn't want to tell her how convicted I got, but I was... But see, she didn't fight me. She immediately started praying and praying peace and telling God and praying peace and telling God and praying peace. So you want to convict your husband, don't walk up to him, you lazy, no good, trifling. Just stand there and say, Lord, I thank you for my husband. Lord, I just want peace in my home. Just let him hear your relationship with Christ about him. That's the way you get to him. You're not going to beat him in the head with the Bible and change his attitude. What you're going to do is get a roaring lion in your face who's going to devour you. Because he don't know these principles. He might know them, but he doesn't know them. Okay? Let's put it down where it really is. Man should know the principle, but you got to get it here. So I'm not condemning these men, but my heart goes out to them. Because see, let me tell you something. I'd like about six of them on this side and six on this. I'd like a group of them that I can fellowship with. Like my atheist friend, I can see him once in a while, but I can't fellowship with him daily. We're unequally yoked. Well, if my men aren't here, I can't fellowship with them because we're unequally yoked. There's so much I'd love to see and do with these men, but I don't see these men. So my heartfelt cry is to God, reach out your arm and anoint them and touch them and just convict them. If for no other reason but to be supportive of their spouse, get them off of that sofa and change their attitude about what only they have to do, but convict them about what they should do. So I encourage you, women, don't beat them over the head. Just pray for them. We're praying for them. We're looking for them. We know what you're going through. And listen, the roles are reversed in some of these issues too. But it's not the woman's role to be the head of the home. So it's not your responsibility. And that's the missing equation. So many women have had to rise to the occasion and perform a role they are not called to be performing. So if anything ever corrects me, I got to make my job my wife's job because I don't want to do my job. And God's looking at me going, why aren't you doing your job? Boy, I'm feeling conviction. I better do my job. But the power of prayer. You perform God's word. God tells the wives, be submissive to your husband. Do the things you're supposed to do. Don't murmur. Don't complain. And do not tell your friends negative things about your husband, no matter what. Submit, do the things you should, but then be bold enough to pray and lift him up. Because guess what? You married him. You got what you got. See, we forget that. I always tell couples that. You got what you got. Well, people change. Yes, they do. If there's no correction ever in there. If there's no guidance, yeah, you'll change every day. But if you follow God's principle, you'll stay the course. You'll renew your mind daily in your attitudes and your thoughts of how am I supposed to do this? My emotions. So I say, women, with husbands missing in action, just love them where they're at. And we just pray that they will start coming into a relationship. You want your relationship to get better with that man, pray that his relationships get stronger with Christ. And then the natural order will take place. See, that's where you got to know the difference. He's not going to love me right now where we're at. But if I can just pray and let God convict his heart and support his relationship and growth with God, then we can get on track. And again, do not talk negative about your spouse to nobody. If you have to counsel with a correct counselor, by the way, there's a lot of counselors out there who aren't the correct counselors, then you go see them as a couple, preferably, because there's all kind of doctrine, opinions, all kind of whirling ideas of what the world's relationship should be, but God's word has not changed on the marriage. His ideas have not changed. He said how the order is supposed to be, and it is still the order that it's supposed to be. Stick with it. Stick with it. Now, I'm a man, and I know I can't say I feel your pain, women, but I do feel it. I do. By the Spirit, I do. I stand in the gap a lot of times for missing men. And it's stuff I don't share here, but there's things I do. But if I just could look at that man and say, oh, buddy, if you would just open your heart up. My friend Wally, who went through that thing, his wife ended up having an adulterous affair. But after he thought about it, he said, you know, I can't blame her. I pretty much shoved her into that. See, she'd want to go to dinner, and I'd want to sit outside and watch TV and drink beer. She'd want to go shopping, and I told her, just go on, I don't want to go. She'd want to go somewhere and enjoy time with them, and he just wanted his buddies there to sit around. He says, if only I would have stopped that nonsense. If only I would have told my friends no and told my wife yes. Even though she shouldn't have done what she did, he knows and he recognizes his part he played by being absent in his marriage. See, he physically was there, but spiritually, emotionally, he was gone. He was gone. Don't put yourself in that situation. Women can take so much, but there is a breaking point. There is a breaking point, men. Don't put your wife to that point of breaking. And again, this isn't just for here. This message goes out. It goes out to the world, and just want to see this thing. If you'll just go back, again, forget the world's idea of it. The world's idea of marriage is wacko, okay? I'll say it plain out. I mean, we got churches proclaiming gay marriage is fine. I mean, let me tell you something. It ain't fine. I'll be glad to talk to anyone who wants to talk to me about what marriage is supposed to be, because I'll just whip out the Bible and read it straight from there. Has nothing to do with my opinion, how I feel. Oh, you know, I just feel that way because my family member. No, it's this. God said. God said. God said. So I encourage you, stay the course. Stay strong. God laid that on my heart. Again, it's not to condemn. Because let me tell you something. I'm in the same boat. I have my days. I mess up. In 1 John, what is it? I got to pick on him. Who can I pick on? If I mess up, Pastor Bob, what do I do?
1 John 1:9.
Yeah. And I didn't really plan on my whole message to kind of be on this subject, but you know, when God leads you somewhere, you just go on to it. But I hope it encourages you. See, we're here to edify, not beat down. We're here to encourage, lift up. And yeah, your circumstance may not be ideal right now, but it's just that. It's a circumstance. It is not your future. It is not your destiny. It doesn't make you hate anybody. It doesn't make a bitter root be there. It is up to you to have the correct reaction to the circumstance. And the blueprint is right here. If you need to know how to react to something, before you open your mouth, open your eyes and read it, and then you'll know the reaction. Then you'll know what to say, or know what not to say, preferably. Again, it goes back to covenant. It's all about covenant. You know, we've got an eternity to spend, but see, right now we're here. We got to go back to the covenant. God, what is my covenant with you? Am I going to honor my covenant with you? And Lord, I know I slip up, but see, if I repent and really mean it, I know you're cleansing me. And I'm not stuck in that bottomless pit. I'm up in the heavenlies with you. We got to remember who we're heirs with, okay? We got to remember the authority we've been given. We got to remember the boldness, the armament we have. We got to know that we are not the worm in the cabbage patch. We serve the King of all kings and the Lord of all lords. We honor and worship Him. In fact, we're so highly thought of, God calls us a friend. A friend. A friend. Now, the world will say, well, you can't be a friend with God. He's God. He made us. He made us for Him. He made us for a relationship with Him. He wants you to be His friend. He wants you to talk to Him. He wants you to lean on His shoulder when you mess up. He wants to lift you up. He's looking for us daily to spend time with Him, to acknowledge who He is, and then to go out to the world and tell them who the God you serve is. Remember, our mission is to spread this gospel. So I encourage you to be bold enough to do that. Be bold enough to zip it when you're supposed to zip it and pray about it. And when it's time to speak, step right on in there and let them hear the Word of God. It's not your opinion. It's not your emotion. If you stick to the principle and the Word, you have boldness. Don't mix it with your ideas. Don't mix it with your opinions. That's where we get all off course. That's why the world thinks marriages are all different and everything's okay and we live in a gray world. Mm-mm. It's very clear. God made everything. He made this universe. And He put this little speck called Earth, and He put the people He created on it that He wanted to have fellowship with. You're so highly thought of about this, amongst this whole universe, you're so highly thought of this little speck in the universe is where He decided to manifest Himself, to be the example, and to be our Savior. Hey, if He thinks that way about me, that's how we gonna start thinking about we. You got it? You got it?
Yes.
You are God's chosen. So walk in that. Talk in that. Lead the example by that. He'll give you the strength you need when you need it. He loves us. Don't let the world tell you any different. God loves each and every one of us. He loves the most devout Christian, and He loves the devout sinner. He loves each and every one of us. There's no gauge. He loves us all. But our free will has to choose to love Him back. And when you love Him back, you get the benefits. I prayed for the wife, and I've got the benefits. If anyone needs prayer, come on up. Hopefully this encouraged you. Amen. You know, the world would think, well, that's kind of harsh. No, it's to encourage and edify and strengthen. And if you need any prayer after Pastor Bob closes us out, come on up. We'll pray about it. And just remember, do it God's way. It's so good to do it His way. You want less trials and tribulations? Do it His way. They're still coming, but you'll be able to face them. They won't knock you off your chair. In fact, you'll get out your chair and you'll walk toward them and crush them.
That's right.
Because you have the powerful one with you. All right? Yeah.